Okay, so we've seen two ways to represent signed integers in binary. Those two were relatively straightforward, but it turns out that they're not so useful for arithmetic. So what most machines use is something called 2's complement, which is unfortunately a little complicated to understand, but the arithmetic works out very nicely, and it's quite efficient, and so that's why most computers use 2's complement. So in 2's complement, we still interpret the most significant bit as a signed bit, so that again is unchanged. In order to think about the value of the number that's being stored, we'll interpret all the bits as an unsigned integer, and then if you have a negative number, the absolute value of that number is going to be 2 to the n minus x, where x is that unsigned value, and n is the number of bits. So what this means is that in order to negate a number, you have to subtract its value from 2 to the n, where n, again, is the number of bits. So here we have some 4-bit numbers. So 2 to the n is going to be 2 to the 4, which is 16. So here we have negative 1, which is represented using 1, 1, 1, 1, or the unsigned value 15. Because if you take 16 and you subtract 15, you get 1, which is the absolute value of negative 1 here. Another example would be, so negative 7 here is stored as 1001. This is a negative number because the first bit is set. The unsigned value is 9, and when we subtract 9 from 16, we get 7. So that is the absolute value of this number. What's somewhat confusing about how this is laid out is that it kind of causes the numbers to wrap around in the middle. And what you've essentially done is you've taken the negative number space and you've sort of slid it up into the positive number space. And so you have these large unsigned positive values that are now allocated to store the negative integers. And so as you start from unsigned values, you have positive values that are the same as their unsigned values. And then at some point you switch over to a very negative number and kind of reset at the bottom of the address of the number space. And then you kind of work yourself back up to negative one. Benefit here is that now we only have one zero. We have the zero, which is the unsigned zero. Because we now only have one zero, we can store one extra either positive or negative number, and we've just sort of made the decision to store one extra negative number. So we'll have one more negative number than positive number. So you can see here that we've got zero, we have 7 positive numbers, and then we have 8 negative numbers. Again, using a 4-bit integer. So you might be wondering why we would use such a convoluted scheme to store numbers, and the reason that we do is that the arithmetic works out very nicely. And in fact, you can just use unsigned arithmetic and you just get the right answer. And this may seem a bit magical right now, but I would encourage you to do some examples to convince yourself that it works out, even if you maybe don't quite understand exactly why that works sort of from a number theoretic point of view, which is not really the focus of this course. So here are some examples of subtraction operations, and then the rephrasing of those subtraction operations as the addition of, you know, two different signed positive or negative numbers, and then these are the 2's complement representations of those numbers, and then you do the arithmetic, and you should write out these numbers and line them up and do the arithmetic in base 2. And what you will get is, if you ignore the sign, ignore any carries out of the sign bit for now, then you will get the answers that are over here on the right, which are the answers that we would expect to get. And there's another example down here. So another way of thinking about this in the visual way that the textbook uses is to think of the most significant bit's value as being negated. In other words, you would then sort of start at the most negative number if you have a negative number, and then kind of build back up towards zero. So whereas for unsigned numbers, all of the bits gave you a positive boost or a positive value, in 2's complement, you could think of that first bit as actually giving you a negative value. So all the other bits are still worth positive 1, 2, and 4, but that bit, that most significant bit, is now worth negative 8. And so it works out. If you think about starting at negative 8, if that bit is set, and then you add, for instance, 1 and 2, then so that's adding 3 to negative 8. That gets you up to negative 5, and this is the 2's complement representation of negative 5. So I told you how to negate. That's not actually how most people negate in 2's complement, so subtracting from 2 to the n. And that's because there's actually a much quicker way of doing the negation in 2's complement. And this relies on you being able to do the flip the bits operation, which was, remember, the negation in 1's complement. So in order to negate in 2's complement, you flip the bits, which we already know how to do, and then add 1. So flip the bits, so here is 5. If we wanted to negate this to get the representation of negative 5, then we flip all the bits, so this will be 1, 0, 1, 0. And then we add 1, which gives us 1, 0, 1, 1. And so that is going to be the representation of negative 5, which is, again, what we saw in visual form on the previous slide. And you may be wondering why this works. The particulars are not super important to this course, but this is a short explanation about why that actually works. And I'm sure you can find other examples of this, or explanations of this online if you go looking. Okay, so now we're going to answer the same two questions that we did before, but for 2's complement. So here is a number. What is the negation of that number in 2's complement? So you should take a moment and pause the video and see if you can work that out. Okay, so remember the trick that we just learned, which is to flip all the bits and add 1. So this will be 0, 1, 0, 0, 1. And then we add 1, which I believe gives us E, if I'm doing this correctly. So we end up with 0, 1, 0, 0, 1, and so we add 1, that'll put a 1 in this place. Yeah, so then the correct answer will be E. So then the last question, which is, so here are those numbers again, and now I'm telling you that we have some bits. The context is that they are 2's complement integers. So which of these are negative numbers? So pause the video and see if you can identify those. And again, so for some students, this feels like a trick question, but it's not. So the rule is still the same. So all three of these signed bit or these signed representations have the same indicator of a negative number, which is that the most significant bit is set. And so regardless of which of these three you're using, if the first bit is set, which it is in these two numbers, then it's going to be a negative number. The absolute value of that negative number is going to be different depending on which encoding you're using. But the fact that it's a negative number is the same across all of the encodings, which is kind of nice.